So the first property I want to talk about is viscosity. So this is the property that is responsible for resistance to motion. So if I try to drag, let's say, a pole through water, then I am going to incur some drag, okay? And a big reason for that is because the flow is viscous. Okay? So let me give you an example. So suppose I take two plates. So these are two parallel plates. So the lower one is fixed, and this one actually I am going to pull it to the right with the speed capital U. And there is fluid in between. Now you can imagine if there was no friction, if there was no viscosity, if it's an ideal fluid, there is no viscosity. And then you can move the plate and the fluid does not even feel it. You can just move the plate. It's like you try to skate on the ice, and because there is, if you assume there is no friction, then actually you just glide over it. That's exactly what will happen here. But suppose there is viscosity, then at t equal to 0, the following would happen. If I drew a line through this line, a line through this section, and then try to draw what is the velocity of the fluid at each point, then I would see, well, it is at rest here, but maybe here the speed is u. And then after a while, it kind of drags in some more fluid, and after a while it drags in some more fluid, and so on. So this I am drawing profiles with increasing time. As time increases, you are going to see that more fluid gets energized because of the motion of the upper plate, and that's essentially because of viscosity. Okay, so viscosity is almost like friction. In fact, one of the outcomes of viscosity is the no slip condition on velocity. Because of viscosity, you will notice that fluid particles that are close to or in contact with the upper plate, they assume the same speed or the same velocity as the plate, and they start moving with it. And then at a later time, it kind of drags the particles below it and below it and below it, and after a while you get more of a fully developed velocity profile. So no slip condition arises essentially out of viscosity. If you had a fluid with no viscosity, we usually refer to it as an ideal fluid, then the no slip condition may not be followed. Okay. How does this look mathematically? Are there some implications of this viscosity? So there's a there's a formula which we will look in more detail later, which is the Newton's law of viscosity, which says that if I have the shear stress tau, then this can be related to mu dv x by dy. Okay. So, mu here is the coefficient of viscosity. Let me explain you this formula a little bit. Suppose I think of this as the x axis and this as the y axis. You will notice that here the velocity field has a gradient in the y direction. So, it is 0 on the lower plate, it is capital U on the upper plate, and there is a variation in between. So, that is this gradient dvx dy. So, how much is the shear stress created in the fluid? Well, it is given by this formula. And mu is a property of the fluid. If I had a more viscous fluid, then for the same velocity gradient, I would generate more stress, more shear stress. If I had a less viscous fluid, then I would generate less viscous stress. So, mu actually is dependent on the fluid. So, some fluids will have very high viscosity and some fluids will have very low viscosity. Very similar to the coefficient of friction. If I take two surfaces, the coefficient of friction would depend on what kind of surfaces they are, and that is the same story with viscosity. So, some people are interested in a quantity called mu by rho. Okay. So, I would like to make a distinction. So, there is another viscous coefficient which is called mu by rho, where rho corresponds to the density. Mind you, both these are called coefficients of viscosity, okay, but they have different names. This one is the coefficient of dynamic viscosity, whereas nu is the kinematic viscosity. In the Newton's formula, mu is the more primary one, but we will see later that nu is also an important quantity. Okay. Let me just for the sake of completeness give you some coefficients for different fluids. So, I want to make a table here for rho, mu and nu. The units are SI units. So, this would be kilogram per meter cube. For mu it is Pascal seconds, and this one is meter square second. The quantities that I want to give you are water, glycerin and SAE 30, oil and finally air. So, you know the density of water is 10 to the third, mu is something like 1 into 10 to the minus 3. So, this becomes 1 into 10 to the minus 6. For glycerin it is 1.25 into 10 to the third. This is 1.5, and this is 1.2 into 10 to the minus 3. SAE oil, it's slightly lighter than water, as we all know, but look at the viscosity. It is far more viscous than water, okay, but less viscous than glycerin. But if you look at the value of nu, that would be something like 0.48 into 10 to the minus 3. Air is another very important fluid. So, the density of air is much smaller compared to water. This I am talking about at sea level. You can look at the viscosity. Okay, so it appears to be less viscous than water. But the interesting thing is, if you go to nu, then you know they are not so different. I mean, not as different as mu makes it to be. So as I said, this nu is an important quantity, and we will talk about it a little later. All right, so this Newton's law of viscosity is essentially for a very special class of fluids, and these fluids are called Newtonian fluids. Okay? And here the idea is that the shear stress is directly proportional to the velocity gradient. You can see this is velocity, the derivative with y, so we call it the velocity gradient. But there are fluids in which the relationship may not be linear, it may be nonlinear, and there are many such interesting fluids. Okay, so let me just give you an overview, because it's very difficult to do the analysis for those fluids in this course. Nevertheless, I want to give you at least a picture of. So suppose on the x-axis I have dvx by dy, which is the strain rate or the velocity gradient. And on the y-axis I want to plot tau, which is the shear stress. So this is what your Newtonian fluid looks like. The linear relationship. Okay. As I said, there could be other fluids where the relationship is not a straight line, it could be a curved line. So right away I will plot two of them. So these are collectively non-Newtonian. You could have something called an ideal fluid, and let me draw that for you. So this is ideal. In the sense that no matter what the strain rate is, it does not generate a shear stress. Okay, so it's, as I said, the analogy would be something like a frictionless surface. Then you would have an ideal solid. So let me draw a solid for you. So this would be an ideal solid. Okay. It does not generate a strain rate, as I indicated right in the beginning of the lecture. So when I put a force on a solid, it deforms. But there is no strain rate, there is a strain. Okay, so it's fundamentally different. So it's a vertical line. So that's a solid, this is an ideal fluid, and of course then a real fluid is somewhere in between. I could also have something called a plastic. So this would be an ideal plastic. That means it it resists up to some point, some shear stress is needed to get it going. And then I could draw other kinds of fluids, but I suppose I will not clutter this figure anymore. So let me just recap for you what I have done. I was talking about properties of a continuum, and then the example that I gave you is of viscosity, and I was able to show you that for a Newtonian fluid, which is a very large class of fluids, you know, all these fluids that I have listed here, water, glycerin, oil, air, they could be idealized as Newtonian fluids. That means they have a linear shear stress versus a strain rate relationship. But if you did not have a Newtonian fluid, then this would not be a straight line, so you would have these curved lines and so on and so forth. Good, so we have done a little bit about what a fluid is. Okay, so now we are ready to do some little bit of analysis. Let me get you started with that. So suppose I want to apply Newton's second law. F equal to M A. And I want to apply this to fluid mechanics. How do I apply it? So if I took a fluid element of a certain mass M and I apply a certain force on it, then it results in an acceleration A. That's what this law tells me. Okay. So what is F? F actually consists of two kinds of forces. There is a body force and there is a surface force. What's a body force? This actually acts per unit volume. So if I took a fluid element, then a body force would act in this manner. On the other hand, this actually acts on the surface. What are body forces? Some examples are due to gravity or an electromagnetic potential. But if I looked at a surface force, then these could be, for example, pressure or, for example, viscous forces and so on. I know how to handle these, the body forces. We have all done that. But it's not very clear how to handle a surface force. So we first want to come up with a framework on how to define a surface force. Okay? So for that, I want to introduce to you the concept of a stress. We've been talking about stress as far as the Newton's law is concerned, but that's a very specific definition. I want to talk about in a very general way. Okay? So please recall certain concepts. So if I want to talk about a surface, so this is a surface, and this surface has area dA, and then it has a unit normal n. So I can talk about that area is actually a vector which is something like n in dA. So what is written here is that in general area is a vector which is associated with a unit normal, and then of course the magnitude of this area. Now if you also recall, stress is defined as force per unit area. So I could in principle say that there is a force acting on this surface, and then I could divide it by the area and I could get the stress. But notice now, if in a fluid I have a fluid flow, let's say in this room, and I take different planes. Okay, now it's a little bit tricky. Depending on the orientation of the plane, my n is going to change, and then it is not clear how I should define my stress. So there's a very interesting recall that stress is force per unit area. So I want to combine these two definitions and come up with the formal definition of stress. So I am going to say, if I have a stress tau, then this is going to be, if I had a force F, then this is so I have written over here that the force is stress times the area, but now I have generalized it that if there is a vector force, then I have to come up with some kind of a vector area which I have indicated in the diagram over there, and then I have to multiply it with this quantity tau here, which is the stress. Stress here is a tensor, and in general it has two indices. Okay, so if you recall that if I write a vector A, then I can talk about one index. So vector A, for example, could be AX I plus AY J plus AZ K. Now this stress has two indices, so it's a tensor. And therefore, I can write it like this. So it is tau xx, tau xy, tau xz, tau yx, tau yy, tau yz, tau zx, tau zy. So in general, the stress tensor has 9 components. These 3 on the diagonals, they correspond to normal stress. And the other ones, for example these, they correspond to shear stress. And by definition, tau is symmetric for equilibrium. I am not showing this to you, but it can be proven. So what it means is that tau ij is equal to tau ji, which implies that tau xy is equal to tau yx, tau xz is equal to tau zx, and tau yz is equal to tau zy. So actually we are left with only 6 unknowns and not 9. 3 normal stresses and 3 shear stresses. Okay. So what we are saying is, if I want to get a force, a surface force, then I must look at the state of stress at a point and then take the dot product of it with an area. And of course this area, as you know, is something like n times this area over here, which is a scalar. Okay. So we are going to stop here and we will continue on this in the next class. Thank you very much.